So advertising. Advertising is everywhere, right? You turn on your cell phone and you'll get an ad for something that you don't want to see. And, you know, so many ads that are already there. A lot of people hate advertising because advertisers ruin everything. You know, email was something which was really great. You used to use it for a lot of things that really mattered. And now you get an email about gold that you can buy from somebody else. Who cares about that, right? So advertisers ruin everything. But advertising has always been there. And hear me out. The flower. A flower is more or less a flamboyant plant particle which is trying to attract this butterfly or maybe another insect because the end goal is to get itself pollinated. Here's another example. This weird looking insect is actually trying to advertise itself. The idea is that what it does is that the spider is also called a pigeon, a peacock spider for some reason. I think maybe because it has this thing going on, and I don't particularly like insects, which is why I'm not getting into the details of it. It also does this really weird dance where it puts both of its hands up, not trying to stereotypically point to a certain group, but you know who this person is. Not saying anything, by the way. So it has always been there, the advertising. It's always been there. And so, you know, advertising has always been there. And now, the point of this talk is not to say that, you know, advertising has always been there, so you should go on with it. The idea of this talk was to make you understand how your actions lead to you being segmented and therefore you seeing a certain ad on digital platforms. But for me to explain that to you, I need to explain what segmentation is and why are you segmented. And so I'm going to do, or at least try to do, is to bring together years of studies that have been done on segmentation and probably explain it to you in the next 18 or less minutes, and which is why I don't think I'm going to be able to do that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you this slide. Please don't try to read it. It's very important. Don't read it. It's very difficult to even, it gives me a headache to even try to read it right now. And so, you know, there are different ways of segmenting the audience. You can segment them on geography, on demography. You can, psychographic segmentation is also something which is very unique. You can do that on digital behavior. But I don't have the time to explain this to you. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to simplify the process of segmentation. And then you can use what is used in most textbooks, which is the AIDA model, which is the whole way of actually segmenting the audience, where you segment them based on the journey that they're in when they're purchasing a certain product. And so you create awareness and interest and desire and action, but who cares about that, right? So I'm going to simplify it even further. Something which is more important to me as a marketer to understand, because you really need to understand where the consumer really is. And to understand where the consumer really is, you have to understand the mindset of the consumer. One of the ways of understanding the mindset of the consumer is more often than not to understand what kind of a consumer this person is. Now, to understand the kind of consumer that a person is, you have to first understand why are we even segmenting people? Why are we taking the pain of understanding what a person wants? We don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. It's difficult in a relationship to understand what the other person wants. I wouldn't want to understand what 1,000 people want. And by the way, I think it's impossible, more or less. So I want to go back to the system. Why did we even start segmenting people? Why did we even start segmenting an audience? And so, you know, I'll break it down as simple as possible so that, you know, we can quickly go through it. And the idea is that, you know, when there was nothing, there was advertising. And when there was advertising, there was a system. And I'm talking about the 50s. And so there would be an advertiser or an ad agency, because you couldn't do it on your own. Even if you were a company, you couldn't do it on your own. You needed an advertising agency to work on your behalf. And you have these ads, A1, A2, and A3. By the way, this is a slide that I want you to read. So you've got A1, A2, and A3, and you've got a publisher. A publisher could be a magazine. It could be a newspaper. It could be anything where you can put your ad forward. And so what you would do is that you will, as an advertiser, go, or as a company, go to the advertising agency and say, you know, I've got these three ads, could you place them? And they would directly call the publisher saying, so I've got three ads, can you place them on your website? Oh, by the way, this is 1950, so maybe could you place it on your magazine, by the way, which people read? And so it was okay when it was simple, but then it got really complicated. Now imagine, this is a it's a very simple case, right? I wanted to say simplicistic, but you know, it's a difficult word to say on stage. I think it's a difficult word to bring along together. I think these words are really difficult. And so I'm going to stick with the simple version. And so the idea is that if you get more and more publishers to come together, it becomes difficult for the ad network or the ad agency to actually bring them and bring you the best price. And so what happened was that brokers came in. the same way brokers came into the real estate world, and they, in some ways they made things better initially and then they ruined it eventually. But and so what ad networks started doing was that they became broking parties between ad agencies and publishers. And what they would do is they would talk to different publishers and say, you know what, sublease me your digital real estate. Or in this case, maybe just a real estate on a magazine, and say, you know what, I'm buying it, pre-buying it from you at a certain price. And then I'd club it all together and send it to an advertiser or an ad agency at a higher market price and get some money in the middle, which makes a lot of sense. And so even that was nice until multiple ad networks came in. So now you've got multiple publishers, multiple ad networks and advertisers. And so the process is completely, it's difficult to even track. Now, one of the bigger problems that has always existed is that when the ad spaces are being rented physically, and if there is a demand for more than one ad space, what that means is that, one, some ad spaces are going to be not utilized. The second problem would always be to optimize the process. And to optimize the bidding process, what you need to do is that you need to bring together this logistics data in and understand what spaces have been occupied and what spaces have not been. And the bigger problem than that is, and it's still trackable on digital, but on non-digital platforms, what you can't do is you can't tell what are the people who are looking at a billboard. You really don't know that. You can guess that, you know, certain kind of people live in this area, but, you know, people travel and people go to different places. This is how we propagate. And so, you know, maybe somebody came there and saw the billboard. And you can't track that. Even on digital platforms, although I can tell you that you've seen a certain ad, I can never be sure if you showed it to someone else after taking a screenshot, for example, right? Although that doesn't happen really. But just to give an idea that it's slightly difficult. And so ad networks did a great deal for the advertising world, because what they started was this idea of being in the middle and creating packets and segments. So one of the things that ad networks did to be more interesting for the advertiser, more useful for the advertiser to pay a markup, was that they would club these spaces available on the publisher's network and then getting some data from the publisher saying, oh, if you're selling a car, I can get you two publishers. One of these publishers is a car magazine, another one is a health magazine, and both of them are read by men, and predominantly these men earn certain amount of money. And that data would then become useful. And in that process, we realized the value of data somewhere. And so, you know, when there were multiple ad networks, people started building new systems. And then one day, and especially with the advent of digital, somebody realized, why are we not selling the user? Why are we selling ad spaces? Why not sell the individual, which would be the user or the viewer when it comes to a website in that case? And so the transition started. The transition was that instead of selling an ad space, we're now trying to sell visitors. And so imagine if I was, let's say for example, a moving website. What would happen is that if I bid on you in particular, it doesn't matter who you look at, the ad will be shown to you. And so if you're looking at me, you'll see the ad. If you look at somebody else, you'll see the ad. It's you that I'm bidding on, and wherever you go, I'll follow you. Like the Hutch dog, by the way. I don't know if you remember him. And so the idea is that with the process of bidding on visitors, what we've done is that we are trying to track the user across the internet, and we bid on you. We sell you, literally. And you know, this is the larger picture. We've got the DSP and the SSP. And these are, again, I've added these to the slide just to make you understand that there's a lot to happen, but we're not going to get into it. Like, you don't want to. But you really want to enter the matrix. Please don't try to read this slide again. But here you are, happy, a cap, a pant that appears slightly tighter than it should be. And what is happening here is that you're being tracked through your unique identifier throughout the internet. You're going to different places, you're using different things, and what the internet is doing to you in a very simplistic manner is that we're trying to track you. We're trying to find where you are, take that data, and then bring it all together. But I haven't explained why do we even segment you, and the reason why we segment you is because we want to sell better. Now, to give you an idea of what segmentation is, a simple way of segmenting people, a very easy way of segmenting people, is to understand the situation that they're in. And which is why I'm going to first explain what segmentation is and then tell you that segmentation is actually full of crap because it doesn't work. And so I'll give you an example. One way of segmenting people is using the matrix, which is the time versus the time on the x-axis and the quality on the y-axis. And so what that means is that there are people who have less time and want to buy high quality products, or they've got a lot of time and they want to buy low quality products. Worst kind of customers, by the way. They'll go around, they'll window shop, they'll spend days and hours of the advertiser, and eventually they won't buy anything because they want the cheap product, they've got a lot of time on their hands. And then there are the mirror opposites of these two spectrums, which is somebody who's got high time and high quality, where you sell luxury products. This could be somebody who's really rich and he or she is also on a vacation, and he or she is interested in a certain product, let's say for example a sneaker, and they're looking to spend money. This is where luxury marketing comes in. And then there is one of the other worst kinds, which is you've got a lot of you've got this very little time, and then you're also not looking for any quality, which is you under an emergency. So for example, you're stuck somewhere and you need a charger. So what you would do is that you'll buy a disposable charger or a disposable pen, because you don't want quality. You're just stuck there and you need immediate usage. And then also, you don't have time. So you're not going to look around for a lot of quality anyway. Now, these appear to be segments which are segmented from each other. These appear to be situations where, you know, they are all separate from each other. They're not separate from each other. A same person could be doing or be in a certain category at different points of time. And I'll give you an idea. So let's say, for example, you work for a certain company, and then what happens is that you've been working really hard, and one of these days, your manager takes you to the boss, and the boss is really impressed, and you worked really hard, and you ask for an appraisal, and you get the appraisal, by the way. And so you're really excited now. You're like, you know what, I'm going to get the appraisal. And so you impress the boss all day, and then you're standing outside just to leave, and the boss comes out and says, you know what, my car has been delayed. Driver isn't here for some reason. And so can you drop me to this certain place, maybe a prime market? And so he says yes, because you know what, you'll get some personal time with the boss, and you'll spend that. And so... so you're on your way, and in this situation, you've got a car, and I'm going to name two products that you're using. One is the tire, something that we don't really care about. Nobody looks at a car and says, oh, nice tires. Nobody does that. The second thing are the pants that you wear. Now, this company has a policy of wearing black pants, black matte pants, nothing more than that. So what you do is you buy them in bulk, because you have to wear them every day. And they also make you work on the weekend, so you hate the company, by the way. So I'm not sure why you're looking for an appraisal. But you buy these pants in bulk, and you don't care about the quality, but you do care about the fit, so you get them well fitted. And so now you're in this car wearing these tight pants, and you've got this low quality tire, and you hit a pothole, and the tire punctures. Maybe it ruptures. You also haven't fixed your stepney or the spare tire, because you're a very unorganized person, and that's your fault, by the way. It's not my fault. And so... you know, you're in this situation now where you're stuck in the middle of traffic, hectic traffic, by the way. You've got a bad tire. And you want to, you know, maybe work around that. Maybe you've got the stepney, maybe it's not punctured and you want to change that. And so you want to go and actually change it. But when you decide I should bend and probably try to change it, you realize your pants are too tight. They're really tight. And the problem is not that they're too tight. It's because the quality of these pants are so low. If you bend more than this, you could rupture them again. So you've got a ruptured tire. The possibility of rupturing a pant, you don't want to make it worse. And this is getting really bad. The situation is getting really difficult because people are coming around, they're shouting at you. And yes, there is an auto stops and there's a kid inside, and the kid is pointing at you. This showing you to his mother, saying that, you know, this, look at this man who's got tight pants. And people are saying, why don't you move the car? Like, you tight pants, I can't do anything. I'm so sorry, but I've got a bad tire, and this is getting irritating. And you know what? Things could always get worse. In an alternate universe, Daenerys Targaryen could stop and say, bend the knee, and you can't think, I've got tight pants, I can't bend the knee. It's very difficult. And the boss gets out, and he's like, you know what, I'm going to leave. And he leaves. He takes the auto, by the way, with the kid. You hate the kid now. Maybe the kid gets your job and then, you know, becomes the CEO of the company later. Things can always get weird. Things can always get weird. You don't want to get there. And so when you go back home, you realize two things. One, your pant is too tight. You realize that. The second thing is that you need to invest in better quality tires. And so what has happened to you through this one incident that I can't track, because I'm not looking into your life that personally, is that you went from being somebody who used to buy in mass bulks these tight pants and these low quality tires to somebody who's now willing to invest in them because you've had this thing happening to you. This is the reason why you don't see relevant ads. If I was to come down and ask you, is there an ad that you remember? Not many of you would remember an ad particularly. Even if you did, it may not be an ad that you liked, and then it might be an ad that was not relevant to you at all. And so here's an interesting thing for you. You can fix it. Some people can fix it. I could probably fix it. In my book, when I was writing my book, I tried to break down the whole customer acquisition process, the awareness, education, research, evaluation, justification phase. And what I did was I took the normal model and I actually segmented it even further to try to listen to what was happening. But you know, all of this comes down to a technology called social listening. And what, as marketers, we do is that we listen to you, we see what you're talking about, and then we try to interpret that data and present to you more relevant ads. And this is how we're trying to fix it. And one of the processes that is involved in this is that when we show you an ad, we try to track what you do with that ad. So let's say, for example, I show you an ad about something, and you click on that ad. It tells me something about you. You like that ad. And if you scroll through it, which you usually do, it tells me that you don't like certain kinds of an ad. Which is why how you behave on the internet, because that is some place where I can track you, I can devise ads that would suit you. And so therefore, a lot of times when you see a really weird ad about diapers, don't look at me as a marketer. You're searching about diapers. You're weird. It's not my fault. It's you who's actually searching that, or maybe somebody else is using your cell phone. Maybe you should look about putting a password on your cell phone. Some young parents are trying to find the best kind of diapers from your cell phone, and you're watching these ads. And this is the flaw in the system right now. We're trying to fix that. If marketers do their job right, which they're not doing right at the moment, but if marketers were to do their job right, and if they were to follow a system of actually making the customer aware, to educate them, to go into the research of actually making them believe that they want the product, to make them go through the evaluation process, explain to them that you know it is and their action is justified, and then make them purchase something, make sure that they adopt the product, retain through it, and then recommend it to other people through amplification and advocacy, you would not end up with tight pants. It would help you. And that is all. Thank you.